Welcome to the Tom Woods Show, episode 324. We're talking about North Korea today in greater depth with our old friend Michael Malice, author and ghostwriter you can check out at michaelmalice.com. He's also the author of the very interesting book, and also very clever book, Dear Reader, the Unauthorized Autobiography of Kim Jong-il. Now, before we get to Michael, let me point out that I'm having my system here completely redesigned in terms of mixers and recording equipment and all that. And as a bridge between here and there, I'm using a, not terrific setup. But we'll need this only for a few episodes. So the sound from Michael's pretty good. I mean, better than I usually get. My sound is okay. Like, it could be better. It's okay. It'll be enough to get us through the next few episodes. You know, I'd like it to be perfect. And within the next couple of weeks, it will be perfect. It'll be super, super great. And then I'm going to share with you my secret. The secret it's taken me a year and a half, to figure out. You potential podcasters, I have got a secret, and I'm going to let you in on it in a couple weeks. But right now, let me turn to my discussion with Michael Malice. Here it is. Michael Malice, welcome back to the show.
Thanks, Tom.
Talking about North Korea today, we did talk a little bit about North Korea, and we talked a bit about your book, Dear Reader, in an earlier episode. I'm going to link to that in the show notes for today. Show notes page for today is tomwoods.com/324. This being episode 324. You were just here on episode 306. I don't know, I'm recycling the guests pretty quickly these days. I don't know what's going on. I figure, hey, Malice is always sitting around like a bum. I can always get him on the show with no problem.
Give the people what they want.
That's right. And I know that when I toss something at him, he's going to come right back at me. It's great. Let's talk first of all about the movie. I mean, it's a little bit late. It's not as in the news anymore, but I'm interested in your analysis of the whole, first of all, the whole controversy surrounding the movie, The Interview, and then your view of the movie. I saw a headline of an article you wrote in which you seemed to say, or which you said, that the movie more or less got major things right about the nature of the regime. First of all, set the stage here. What was your opinion about the real culprit in the whole Sony leak issue?
Oh, okay, so okay, there's a lot to cover here. Let me do it as concisely as possible. So I've had good sources tell me that there's no way it was possible that it was North Korea. And I've had good sources tell me that it absolutely certainly was North Korea. So I can't really answer that. What I can answer is this. We know, and the U.S. government has said this, that we have been hacked by China. We know that we have been hacked by Russia, and both of them have gone after like military stuff, not, you know, some, you know, stoner comedy. And those weren't really a problem. But when North Korea, let's suppose this really happened, hacked Sony, you have Newt Gingrich on the air calling for war. And I think what that speaks to is it's a lot easier to yell at the weird fat kid being North Korea than it is to yell at the jock on steroids, which is Putin or China. So I think that's kind of emblematic of American foreign policy, and that's something that people should keep in mind. That said, I'm going to disagree slightly with something you just said. You said that The Interview, it's kind of faded from public consciousness, and that's true. However, that movie is very important vis-a-vis North Korea, and I was shocked that I'm saying this, because when I saw the preview of the film, I was very concerned that it was doing the same thing that everyone gets wrong vis-a-vis North Korea, which is that the leaders are these fat, wacky, you know, goofballs who don't really know what they're doing, and aren't they silly? And that denies them moral culpability of, you know, orchestrating the worst country in the world, you know, using food to fuel political obedience and sending people to concentration camps still to this day, sending entire families. So in the preview for the movie, there's at one point where Kim Jong-un turns to James Franco and vis-a-vis Katy Perry, he's like, oh, I've never heard this before. And I'm like, this movie's going to be completely terrible. But I met a refugee last week and she said, no, you really should watch it. You're not giving it fair credit. I'm like, okay, yeah. She knows what she's talking about. So I'm going to watch it. And that scene in the preview when Kim Jong-un says, you know, I've never listened to Katy Perry. That's him just trying to play cool to James Franco. And the movie really makes him out to be purely an evil, corrupt villain. And I was shocked, which is very hard to do in a comedy, that he's portrayed in this way. I mean, that's something I've done with my book, Dear Reader, is, you know, to kind of use comedy as an excuse to, you know, explain North Korea and how it got to be this way. And there's several points in the film where they take the North Korean regime to task. And my one favorite moment is when James Franco is talking to Seth Rogen's character, and James Franco says, Kim Jong-un's not a bad guy. He's just, you know, been put in a difficult situation. And Seth Rogen, and I know this family show, so I'll censor him, just looks at him and goes, you are effing ignorant and you are effing stupid. And that really is kind of him giving the finger to so many in the public who really think North Korea is this carnival, whereas it should be the greatest source of horror possible. And, you know, I frequently, when I do radio interviews, they'll start off talking with, you know, ha ha ha, Kim Jong-il had a perfect golf score. And I have it down to about 45 seconds before the people are almost in tears, you know, as I explain the layers of hell that people have to live in North Korea. And these radio hosts go from vapid to being like, what did I ever think was funny about this place? But this is why that movie is still important. It shows Kim Jong-un as a laughingstock. And what my refugee friend pointed out is people in North Korea believe that we are in fear of Kim Jong-un, that we quiver in our boots. And the fact that this movie shows us being willing to look at him as a loser and as a joke is something unfathomable to them. And, you know, the thing with House of Cards, once you pull one away, the entire edifice falls. So, yes, it's faded from public consciousness in America, but people are going to be increasingly aware of it in North Korea. And once they're aware that this is how we look at Kim Jong-un, they're going to start thinking some very uncomfortable questions for the regime.
I wonder, by the way, how people in North Korea thought about what happened in Eastern Europe in the late 1980s, or if they were allowed to see it. Because I was just looking at a documentary the other day about Nicolae Ceaușescu in Romania, who more or less was able to stand aloof a little bit, at least for a little while, from the mass demonstrations going on throughout Eastern Europe. But eventually, they got hold of him and they killed him. And this is a guy who just 2 weeks earlier had been standing up before the country and the government, and was getting the usual cheers and standing ovations. And two weeks later, he's got a bullet in his head.
Right.
I wonder if anybody living in an oppressive regime has to be inspired by something like that.
Oh, no.
Do you have any sense of how they viewed this, or were they able to view it?
Oh, this is I go through this extensively in my book. But let's talk about this. This is a great example for, you know, fans of liberty. Ceaușescu was by far regarded as the worst of the, you know, communist dictators in Eastern Europe. In fact, in 89, when Poland and all these other countries are falling away from Soviet influence, and Gorbachev's refusing to send in the tanks, he was the one berating Gorbachev, you know, insisting you've got to put these people down. And Gorbachev said no. Ceaușescu was the worst because he had gone to North Korea, saw what the great leader Kim Il-sung had done in North Korea, and said, I'm going to import this to Eastern Europe. So Romania was the worst because Ceaușescu very much followed the North Korean model. Now, what did that mean for North Korea? Well, in North Korea, on the regime level, Kim Jong-il took that footage of Ceaușescu being killed, and he played it for everyone at the top leadership positions. Literally every day, he made them watch the videotape, and he says, this is what will happen to you if the masses ever get out of control. He told them explicitly, you will be personally killed, just like Ceaușescu, if we lose our grip on power. So when people say that North Korea needs to liberalize, the people at the very top understand perfectly well that they themselves will be killed. Look at Gaddafi, look at Egypt, you know, Slobodan Milosevic. So there's a huge incentive for these people in the power structure, not just from selfish, you know, power hunger reasons, but for self-preservation reasons. That's number one. Number two is North Koreans are regarded as crazy here, but they're actually brilliant with their propaganda. And one of the things they say is, this is why it's important that Kim Jong-il followed Kim Il-sung, because if you have a bad leader follow a good one, like Khrushchev following Stalin or Gorbachev being the worst, the entire revolution collapses. And rather than the Eastern Europe being something to inspire the masses, this was proof that the yellow toxic winds of capitalism will destroy your country. And they are very, very proud that they are the ones left standing while the rest of the Soviet bloc fell apart.
All right, that's very interesting. It's almost like we canned this, you know, that question, because that's such an interesting answer. And you're saying, if I can jump back to something you said a few moments ago, you seem to be suggesting that the general public of North Korea, if they get wind of the fact that their leader, who is portrayed as this colossus bestriding the earth and of whom everyone shivers in fear, is in fact a figure of ridicule, that even just a shift like that in the public consciousness could be enough to delegitimize the regime to a dangerous degree?
Absolutely. And the other thing is, you know, this reminds me, one of the and I can speak to this being born in the Soviet Union, one of the big things that delegitimized the Soviet Union were trashy 80s soap operas like Dallas and Dynasty, where one didn't have to be, you know, some kind of political sophisticate or philosophy major to see how the people were dressed and wonder, why am I wiping my butt with newspaper? You know, so it was just like, why are we waiting in lines to get milk when poor people, you know, have more gallons of milk than they can handle? So the power of bad television, we mock it because, you know, it's drivel and it's meant for the masses. But at the same time, it's very telling. So when they see how things are portrayed, that says a lot more than any sort of, you know, flyers or press releases or propaganda. It's like, wait a minute, if they are empowered to, there's a scene where Kim Jong-un is making out with James Franco while they're both drunk, right? Now, it's unthinkable that, I mean, Kim Jong-un is deified. So the idea that, like, you know, you'd have some kind of, even in the West, like, you know, Mary and Joseph making out in a movie, people would be very taken aback, and, you know, often rightly so. But for him to be making out with a man in a country where homosexuality is unknown while drunk, will completely blow people's minds. And again, they don't need to see it. They need to know, just through whispering, this is really what they think of him. And then a lot of other questions start following pretty quickly.
Michael, when you were preparing your book, Dear Reader, you spent some time in North Korea. Yes. Does the regime just allow you to just free access to the country to go anywhere you want, see anything you want to see?
Does the American regime? No. So when you go there, and I'm writing an article right now about why everyone should visit, you are there as their guest. So you are taken on a guided tour. That said, people think that's so ominous, but it's not unusual for any country when you go to visit to have a tour guide. The tour guides are not, you know, some kind of government spies. They speak English perfectly, whatever language it might be. And they do take you to certain places, but the idea that everything is fake is also, you know, untrue. You're taken to their capital city, you're surrounded by the populace, and the capital city, they take themselves very seriously, and they have this point of pride living in Pyongyang. You have to have a certain, you know, high social background to even step foot in that city. If you're disabled or, you know, unattractive, they kind of banish you from the city and send you to the countryside. That's how insane it is. But it's very fascinating because they don't really have electricity, so they can't really put on this show of how wonderful it is, because you can't not notice that, you know, every chair is going to have a scratch on it, or, you know, the lights aren't on, things like that.
What do you make of the relationship between the United States and North Korea over the past, well, even just the past several years? But you'll recall that North Korea was listed among the axis of evil. It seemed a little bit, I mean, nobody denies it's an evil regime, but it seemed anomalous and a bit out of place in the context of Islamic radicalism for Bush to suddenly to bring it up.
But that's the whole thing, is that's not anomalous. And I thought it was anomalous at the time. And of course, in the book, Kim Jong-il rails. And he's not, of course, in any kind of cahoots with Iran and Iraq. But in the 80s, you know, North Korea regards Korea as one country split into two by the U.S. imperialists, right? So whenever they write North or South Korea, the N or the S are lowercase, because these are two regions of one indivisible nation.
Right.
And in the 80s, neither country was recognized by the UN, and Seoul was granted the Olympics. And Kim Jong-il contacted the people in Seoul, and he said, hey, why don't we share the Olympics with Pyongyang? And it'll be a great message to the world that Korea is indivisible. And he neither understood nor seemed to care that the Olympics are granted to a city and not a country, and it's not transferable like a check. So you can't just say, you know, the International Olympics Committee granted to me, but I'm going to share with my buddy over here. So Seoul refused. So what did Kim Jong-il do? He sent two of his agents on a plane, and they placed the bomb on the plane. They stepped off the plane when they made a transfer. The bomb blew up and killed everyone on board. And when the two were apprehended, the two agents pretending to be a husband and wife, the man and the woman both had preloaded cigarettes with cyanide capsules like James Bond. They started smoking them. He died and she didn't. And she, you know, they later broke her. She was pretending to be a Japanese agent, but having grown up in North Korea, they were asking her questions like, "What street did you grow up on? What was your favorite candy growing up?" And she would say that she had no idea. She'd never known Japanese streets, never seen Japanese candy. And if she confessed, and what's insane is that the president of South Korea granted her a pardon, a full pardon. She's walking around Seoul right now because the blame went to Kim Jong-il and Kim Il-sung. So there is a reason why they were on that axis of evil. And not only that, that's why Madeleine Albright went to visit North Korea, because when you are on this, like, I forgot what the official status is, nation that harbors terrorism list, that has severe economic consequences. So that was his attempt to get that strike against his record revoked. And again, this was only a few months before Bush was inaugurated. So there's some justification for him putting North Korea in that axis of evil, although as an axis, it doesn't make sense in a mathematical sense.
What is your opinion of the wisdom or otherwise of the U.S. presence over in Korea? I mean, in terms of having U.S. forces stationed there.
It's this probably the same as yours with forces stationed anywhere. I mean, it makes absolutely no sense. South Korea can handle North Korea pretty well, and North Korea is not suicidal. I mean, one of the big arguments people say is they're crazy, they're suicidal. It's like, if they're suicidal, how is it they're the last one standing? You know, a suicidal person will be the first one to go. And the example I always use, you might remember last April, there were these photographs of Kim Jong-un threatening to nuke Austin in Los Angeles. He had the map behind him, and friends of mine were contacting me like, oh, you know, this guy's crazy. And I go, if you're going to nuke somebody, why would you warn them, you know, that nukes are coming to Austin, number one? And number two, the way to look at them is like a bank robber. There's two types of bank robber. There's the bank robbers that go in the bank, start shooting at the ceiling, and they say, give me all your money. You give them the money, they leave, it's fine. And then there's the bank robber that comes in and starts shooting people. Now, the first one, you know, might be an evil person, but he's not completely crazy. He knows if he starts taking hostages and killing people, the consequences will be much more severe than if just some money is taken. And that's what North Korea has been doing. When they fire their missile, they fired into the Sea of Japan. They didn't fire into Tokyo. They didn't fire into Seoul. So what Americans don't understand is so much of their propaganda is for external purposes. And we laugh at the North Korean populace unnecessarily, unfairly, for buying into the propaganda. But everyone in the West buys into it hook, line, and sinker with a straight face.
All right, let's switch gears away from this. I want to ask you something I didn't ask you when we talked about your book, which is you have read, and this was something that you put in the Kickstarter video initially at the very beginning of this project, is that you were going to be reading books in North Korea that basically no Westerner has read.
Right.
And this was going to give you a unique, I mean, your book is already unique being an unauthorized autobiography. I mean, it's a very interesting model that you have, but the fact that you read things that basically nobody else has read, what kind of insights do you have that, well, frankly, nobody else has that are important for people to know about?
It's one of the biggest insights. It's these books are so much. So I read 60 books to craft Dear Reader because I wanted to get everything possible about North Korea in there. I wanted someone who's interested in the subject to read this and have a full understanding and to make North Korea comprehensible to the layman. But you read these communist books and it's very hard to describe how monotonous they are and also how achronological. Because in these books, it'll be like Kim Jong-il went to a factory. There's a problem with the factory. He suggests the solution. No one had ever conceived such a solution. The solution works. And then the next chapter, you know, there's another factory and there's another problem. Gee, I wonder what happens here. So, but this is very telling in terms of how the communist and the totalitarian regime breaks down people's critical thinking, because these stories don't ever have anyone's names other than Kim Jong-il or his father, Kim Il-sung. It'll say an official or a factory worker. They won't have times. They won't have dates. There's one story that just began with President Kim Il-sung went to a European country one year for the funeral of their leader. And when you take away facts like data points and time and other people, it creates this sense of unreality, which is kind of this most extreme version of political propaganda, which is facts are completely irrelevant. All that matters is the narrative and the story. And it really creates this kind of disconnect between the reader and reality when they're, you know, kind of believing in all these fairy tales that are, you know, have no place in history. And they start to look at, I guess, all history in the same kind of vein. It's very, very chilling when you read between the lines. And I do not envy, of all the torture that happens in North Korea, having to memorize these, you know, awful, awful stories that have no point and no payoff is just brutal. There's something else that I can speak to about this. I met a refugee last week, and she was telling me how, you know, all the classrooms in North Korea, they raise rabbits. You know, they raise them for their fur and for their meat. Fine. It's a great little project for the class. Saturday nights, they all had to spend Saturday nights in the school. I think it was 7 p.m. to 5 a.m. To make sure that the American spies didn't come and steal these rabbits. Now, I don't know why the American spies are only working on Saturdays. I certainly don't know why they have to cross an ocean to get these rabbits. And I don't know why the entire class had to be there instead of two people. But if at an early age, you're forced to do such things over and over, by the time you're an adult, you're going to be pretty obedient with regards to the most absurd questions and tasks forced on you. So they get them very young, and it's very pervasive and pernicious. And I don't think we as Americans can really appreciate what that's like.
I think a lot of times libertarians are inclined to think to themselves that we really have to focus. We have only so much energy, only so many resources. So I'm going to focus my attention on the enormities of my own government. I'm going to focus my attention on what the U.S. government is up to and so on. And that's how I incline, just because that's the only country where I have any expertise anyway. So that's where I focus my attention. Why does it matter what's going on in North Korea? I mean, this is a long way away. We don't know anybody over there. It's very unfortunate, but we don't live in a regime like that. We're not going to live in a regime like that. So from a purely selfish point of view, why does it even matter? In other words, why should Western libertarians care about this? I want you to make your pitch for that.
I can go into the whole values. I hate it when people say this is important or that's important. If it's not important to you, there's very little you can do, and that's fine. But what I felt was important was, if people care about liberty, and if people, and this does not apply just to libertarians. I think everyone in the West is libertarian vis-a-vis North Korea. There's a complete consensus that they need more liberty, no matter where you are in the political spectrum. But I thought, if people care about concentration camps and children starving in the street, but they don't know what's really going on, just like John Galton, Atlas Shrugged, I'm going to do something about this. All I could do is write books, and I'm like, you know what? If I'm a libertarian if I'm a layman and I want to understand North Korea, I don't have that option. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to do something about it. I wrote this book to give people that option. And the more people who read, and the more I'm in a position to, you know, give interviews and talk about it, the more people are understanding just how pernicious it is, just how evil it is. And yeah, maybe they can't, but also gives you a lot of perspective. I mean, once I've been there, you know, me being Jewish, being born in the Soviet Union, those are two chances for me to be in a concentration camp. And when you go there and you visit and you hear the children in their schools, the best of the best, and how they cough, knowing they're never going to have warm clothes or medicine, it really gives you perspective in terms of, you know, if I'm a little cold walking to the train, I'm not going to be complaining. So, and I think it's just also very important to understand, this is what totalitarianism actually means. It's not just people having some, you know, wacky perspectives on their leader and going to school and skipping down the street. It means every aspect of your life being completely taken over. So I think people who are interested in just any sense of human rights or humanity or ideas, I mean, this is where the ideas of evil are being put into practice thoroughly and fully, and they have been for 70 years. And hopefully it won't be a teaching tool for much longer.
Well, that is where we're going to leave it. Of course, we'd love to be able to make a prediction here on this show about how long the regime is going to last. But do you think there's a reasonable chance that in our lifetimes, you and I are young-ish?
I wouldn't have said this a month ago, but I am saying it now. I think this is the beginning of the end, because again, this is what it felt like before the USSR fell apart. When the healthiest thing to take down totalitarianism is cynicism. And that is what's starting to creep in. It's very easy to convince an isolated population that they have it great. It's impossible to convince an isolated population that you have more food on your plate this year than you did last year, or that it's a good thing that your children are hungry. And when it comes down to an animalistic thing of, I want my kids to have food, all the books in the world and all the brainwashing aren't going to make that much of a difference, and you're going to be hungry for a different perspective.
Am I allowed to ask you, by the way, what project you're working on now?
Oh, yes. I worked with comedian D.L. Hughley's on his first book. It was called I Want You to Shut the F Up, and now we're working on the sequel.
Are you allowed to tell us the title of that one?
Yes, it's about Obama, the Obama administration, and it's called Black Man, White House.
Oh, that's okay. You told me about this. Okay, so that's what. Okay, yeah, I remember our conversation. I remember the first line. I think you told me the first line of the
book.
Well,
I can't repeat that on this show.
You can't repeat that. No, that's right. But and I got the joke, and I think that impressed you, like my intelligence
you
level.
You did, because
yeah, that's right. That I got the joke.
Yeah.
Well, great. Well, listen, Michael, thanks for this conversation. I hope people will check out Dear Reader. We're, of course, going to link to it at tomwoods.com/324. And, of course, we'll have you on some other time when we can, you know, maybe next time we'll try and argue about something. That's always fun.
Yeah, Jefferson, huh?
Maybe we'll talk about Jefferson, although for that I'd be inclined to bring Kevin Gutzman on, let the three of us go. Well, I'll be an impartial arbiter.
Okay.
And you guys can go at it. It'll be a lot of fun.
I love it.
Thanks so much, Michael.
Thanks, Tom.
All right, everybody, that's the show for today. Check out the show notes page at tomwoods.com/324, not only for details about today's episode, but also for a link to the free ebook that I've just released called 14 Hard Questions for Libertarians Answered. There'll be a link to that at tomwoods.com/324. And while you're there, click on the graphic and find out about what is inside the Tom Woods bag of goodies for people who support the show. I don't think there is any show that gives away more stuff than I do for people who support it. I mean, if I'm wrong, go ahead. I would love to be proven wrong, and then I'll apologize and I'll take it back. But I don't think anybody gives away more stuff than I do. So check that out at tomwoods.com. You'll see it also on the show notes page, tomwoods.com/324. Tomorrow we're going to talk about the corporation. This is a controversy among libertarians. Should we be against the corporation? Because aren't corporations creations of the state? Well, there are warring camps over this issue, if you can believe that. And we're going to do our best to resolve it tomorrow. So make sure you're subscribed to this show on iTunes or Stitcher, because you're getting a daily serving of liberty education. You're becoming a better debater, more knowledgeable. Why would you not subscribe? After all, it's free. You can subscribe at tomwoods.com. Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow.
The Tom Woods Show.